Welcome to another episode of Data Journeys. This is where we come to learn from data leaders that have experienced amazing growth, amazing transformation, and have lessons they're going to share with us. Today, I have the pleasure to talk to Renee. He's the tech lead at Bol.com. And so, Renee, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us today. Let's start from the top. What is Bol.com?
So Bol.com is the largest online retailer in the Netherlands and Belgium. We are out there for 20 years already. And so far, we've managed to hold off competitors like Amazon. So very happy with that. We're not just selling our own products. We have over 45,000 partners on our platform. And together, we can sell up to 1 million items a day, for example, on Black Friday. So that's who we are.
And you sell about 30 million items a year. So you've got a lot of volume, a lot of data. So let's talk a little bit about the use cases that you're solving today with data analytics from Google.
BigQuery is everywhere in our company. So if there's data, then it will end up in BigQuery. So what happened is last year we started with the COVID situation, and it meant that our sales went through the roof. And normally we carefully prepare for the holiday season. There's like a 6-month preparation cycle. And now everything exploded. So of course, this was a time where it was extra important to have our analytics ready so that we can keep steering all our processes and not disappoint our customers. And at the same time, keeping our delivery promises.
And your data was already growing fast, but it's grown 60% year over year, over 100 IT teams providing data into your BI environment. So what are the types of use cases you're solving with the platform? What issues are you solving for?
So one of my goals is to make BigQuery a low entry platform. So lots of people solve the problems that they think are important, and I'm not even aware. So we provide a low entry platform where people can solve their day-to-day issues. So savvy business analysts can check their own product and go into the data set to check one anomaly. But we also use it all the way at the top. So the business intelligence curated daily sales report, for example, comes through BigQuery, and even parts of our general ledger are now running in BigQuery. So all data that is in services will be going to BigQuery if there's an extra analysis need.
So the data ends up anywhere in marketing, in finance, in sales, all the way to the executive boardroom. Let's talk a little bit about the journey of the data. Where does it start? What does the stack look like today?
So I think most of our data is generated internally. So there's one large stream that is, for example, the clicks on the website. That's what we call the click stream. That's one very large stream that has a special treatment. And then there are microservices. So there are well over 1,000 services in the company. And I think 200 of them provide like a standardized BigQuery data set. And so with these data sets, we can combine everything. So logistics information, or preferences, or items bought together, like recommendations is something that comes out of this combination of data sets.
Recommendations like product recommendations?
Yeah, so we have a recommendations pipeline. And if you click on the website, it's able to update sometimes even before you hit the next page. So in between page visits, you will get updated recommendations. And these are based on like historic data in BigQuery, like what people bought together, for example, and then augmented in real time with what you are looking at. Okay, that's also a valuable, I would say, one of the most valuable flows.
And you have a fairly broad use of the Google platform. You have PubSub, Cloud SQL, you use Spanner, you use Dataflow for real time, you use Databrock and BigQuery. So how do these kind of blocks come together? What do you start with? And obviously, you explained that you end in BigQuery. I'm just curious about the journey leading to that.
Well, so we make usually a distinction between IT teams that are usually producing the data, and then the data is in BigQuery and then taken up by our business intelligence teams and distributed to what we call the end users or business users who can actually correlate the data to the business needs. So what will happen is that a microservice will decide that they want to publish a BigQuery data set. They will use our middleware called Stanley, and that allows them to provide a standardized data set. So the data that is in this Stanley format is recognizable by analysts. And that will then end up on BigQuery. And from there, depending on the sensitivity, it can be freely accessible, or people need to ask for access. And most of the post-processing will take place with Airflow or Composer and scheduled queries from there.
What are the types of tools that are interfacing BigQuery today, using Tableau, using Data Studio, and then how do you break it up across the departments? Is it kind of free service for everyone, or you figured out a way to make sure that people follow a particular path?
So what I just described with Stanley is like the producing part, getting the data there, and then visualizing and working with it is a second part. I must say that the BigQuery editor has become really good last year. So sometimes people don't even need to leave the Cloud Console. But if they do want to provide a report, then company curated reports are delivered in Tableau. And at a lower level, we're trying to see if we can incorporate Data Studio so that people can create reports with more ease at the department level, for example.
That's great. Tell me more a little bit about Stanley. It's a code name for the middleware product that you have to deliver the data. So it's the data platform. What's part of Stanley and how did you build it?
Stanley had a predecessor. The predecessor was called Eddy, and its goal was to deliver data to Hadoop. And it was like a monolithic server where you can send an XML message and it would end up in a table on the Hadoop cluster. So for BigQuery, there was a project called Stanley, and it consists of a client SDK that is incorporated in the servers that sends data, and a small server that can process the data on the other side and put it in BigQuery. And it has some additional functionality. So to comply with the GDPR, for example, it can forget data if a forget statement is sent for an entity.
Did you retire Eddy then, or what happened to Eddy?
I was actually the one shutting Eddy down at some point. So I guess also our cloud migration was triggered at some point by our Hadoop cluster slowly filling up. And it was put there once by definitely skilled consultants, but to replace it in-house, just starting with the capacity calculation is like a nightmare. How many servers do we need to run? And so we left that behind and went to the cloud.
So we talked about data infrastructure and how you get the data in a stage that it can be used with high quality. What are some of the use cases that you're particularly proud of?
Most proud of the general ledger, mostly because I was part of the recent audit where it passed without problems. So what it does is that every sale that is made on our webshop that can be either an item sold by ourselves or one of our partners goes to a number of transactions. So of course, there's the amount paid by the customer. And depending on whether it's a partner sale or not, we have to pay it out. Depending on whether or not they use our logistics service, we have to make additional payments. And we combine this together. So you have one sale on the webshop. You have some logistic costs associated, some warehousing costs, some partner commission. And to put all these amounts into perspective in a stable system, we use BigQuery. And it does the job very well.
So René, we learned a lot about your migration and your journey. Lots of people are wondering, well, what did René do that I must absolutely go do today? So what are your three do's here? Things that people need to absolutely do tomorrow to be as successful as you are?
They should definitely provide business users with their own projects. So what we see is that we can provide a low entry barrier, but there's of course also the problem of who pays and what's the risk of a bad query. And so we solve that by giving business teams their own projects. They can use it as scratch space, they can share data, they can share queries. It works very well for them. And it's a scalable way for us to provide this. We just give a team a workspace and the people in that team can go wild. If they go too wild, then we'll notify them and see if we can help them.
How do you police for that? So I know you probably have a flat rate system today with BigQuery, but how do you make sure that queries don't get out of hand, cost doesn't get out of hand? I mean, I know you're giving them the accountability and the access, but how do you govern all of that?
Flat rate plays a large part in that. So flat rate guarantees that we don't run into surprises with our bills. Inside the flat rate, we set up a hierarchy. So we have one set that's called business critical that is related to our warehouse operations. That one's always executed first. And then two or three tiers lower are what we call the business projects. And so basically they can use all idle capacity at any moment. And that's a safe way to provide maximum performance to them. We actually monitor this with some bots and scripts. So we have a chat room where a bot will notify us if an alert is triggered, for example, in Grafana.
So let's talk a little bit about Grafana. Like, how does that work? So you've got alerts telling you when queries are performing poorly. How does that work? How often do you get these alerts? How do you orchestrate?
So there are basically two ways to go about this. The first one is to use Stackdriver metrics that basically gives you some insight in what's going on in projects. So that's also how we started. So we can use Grafana to easily use the Stackdriver metric and put an alert on it and then notify us in the chat room. The first alert we made, for example, was is our slot pool full? Well, on Monday morning, it's always triggering because that's when everybody is doing their weekly work. And then the second part, where we get a bit more sophisticated, is by using BigQuery's information schema tables, which holds information on each job that has been completed. And that's where we actually can sort of spot bad apples or changes.
So you have a system that's, first of all, you've taken care of the price lack of predictability by going to flat rate, but also you're now watching performance and the use of the platform by creating real-time alerts. Those are in real time, correct?
Yeah, it's real time. So the good thing is that it's correlating with business use. So if we are in the chat room with our sort of administrators, then you will see the alerts popping up throughout the day if something happens.
That's excellent. So that's our best practice number one. Let's talk about now the opposite, which is something that people need to avoid. What did you learn through your journey, and what should people watching us watch out for?
I think using Data Studio in an enterprise setting can be tricky. So what's important to remember is that Data Studio is not an official Google Cloud product, but it's part of the marketing suite. So basically, we have to treat it as a sort of sheets or document. And that makes it behave a lot different than what we're used to with our cloud provisioning.
What about the area of security and governance? So, you know, what should people avoid?
Yeah, I have a book here. It's Cloud Native Transformation from O'Reilly. I read it back to back. It's a few hundred pages on good practice and best practices on cloud. I was very happy to see that we applied most of it, except for do as much security as you can upfront. And I can tell from experience that delaying it will not make it less painful. In fact, it will make it more painful. So don't take a shortcut with security. Just rather figure out something else if you can.
If you had to start it over, what would you start with from a security standpoint?
Well, we started it with the cloud as a sort of in an experimental way. So we put in data that was not sensitive at all. And then at a later stage, we wanted to add personal information, for example. And then we run into a lot of issues. Because of the experimental nature, we did not define the architecture very well. So we had to reverse engineer it and then apply new measures. So we did succeed, but I think the lack of architecture sort of killed us here.
So basically, you start with non-sensitive data, test your platform, and then you move up the level of sensitivity as you learn. What about data quality?
So that's one of the do's, I would say. So people start putting in data, you have the low threshold, it's working very well. And then you have all these data sets. And the people that work in finance, they are used to cross-check results and make sure that the data is really correct. But a lot of people are already happy that they have access to the data and will just run a report and go with it. But that does not mean that the data itself is in good shape. So there can be all kinds of discrepancies between BigQuery and the original database. So we also built a separate tool for that, that can check per hour or per 30 minutes if there are discrepancies between BigQuery and the relational database, so that we make sure that the reports on BigQuery are reflecting the true state of things.
How does that work?
It basically is based on a time window. So we first started with a sort of complete comparison, but that doesn't work for data that changes fast or frequently. So it works on with a time window, and within that time window, it will detect synchronization errors between the source and the target. And at first, it will hash a lot of records, take a lot of records, see if they are correct. If there's an error in that, the checksums do not match between remote and local, then it will start zooming in until it will point you to the record that is not correct.
Is this a tool that you built yourself, or did you buy the...
No, we built it ourselves. But I would say that the ideas or technology behind it are not new. But we wanted to provide an easy integration endpoint for the teams.
What did you use to build it?
Most of our internal tooling is running on Java or Kotlin these days.
Excellent. So you've got a system to check quality that you built yourself, and that's going to allow you to scale to thousands of users. Rene, well, thank you so much for the time today. We learned about data quality, we learned about governance, and we learned about a great book that everybody needs to go out and get, the Cloud Native Transformation book from O'Reilly. If you want to find out more about stories just like this one, click on the link down below. I hope that you can connect directly with Rene as well. Until next time, I'm Bruno Ziza.